Well, good morning, everybody. We are glad that you can be here with us this morning as we celebrate the life of Laura Jean Castle. My name is Ben Garotti, and on behalf of myself and our staff and Pastor Arlen, we want to welcome you to this service, a service that, you know, the Lord tells us in His Word to render honor to whom honor is due. And anytime we have a family member, a friend, daughter, mama, those kind of people so dear to our hearts, we want to honor them. While I was not well acquainted with Laura, I'm looking forward to that special sharing time that will take place from some of the family members that are here today, and I'm looking forward to that. Jared and I worked together for a spell around 24 years ago. I can't believe how quick time flies by. We worked at a little company called Galiso, and we have remained friends ever since. Jared shared with me that Laura never wavered in her faith. She was a hardworking woman who loved God and family. Therefore, friends and family, I want you to be encouraged. For in Psalm 90, we are told that we finish our years like a sigh. Their boast is only labor and sorrow, for soon it is cut off and we fly away. And so we ask the question, where does the Christian go? And the Apostle Paul answered that question when he wrote in the New Testament book of the Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. He said, we are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Thus, the Christian's soul has flown away to heaven, and on the day of resurrection, they will receive a new body and a revived spirit. And friends and family, be encouraged, for at the resurrections, Christians will see each other again. While you are here, if there's anything that we can do for you, for here our staff at Calvary Chapel, please let us know. One of our ushers is ready to serve you. If you don't know where the restrooms are, just go out the double doors right here on the side to your left, and the drinking fountains are there as well. But if you need anything else, please let us know. On behalf of the family, Jared Tan and the family, they want to acknowledge you for being here today. There's nothing like having friends and family come as we celebrate this type of a service. So they want to thank you for being here today. They also want to thank you for your friendship to them and to the family as well. So let's pray. Lord, we ask you for your continued comfort, especially for Jared, Tanner, and this close family, Lord, so close. We don't pretend to understand all of your ways, but we do know that you are sovereign. And we ask for your peace that passes our understanding. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. We are going to begin with the reading of the obituary. We're going to ask Tom Appelhans to come up, and if you can share with us. Tom?
Morning, everybody. Like Pastor Ben said, I'm Tom, better known to Aunt Laura as Tommy. Yeah. Excuse me. Lifelong resident of Montrose, Laura Jean Castle passed away unexpectedly on Monday, March 4th, 2024. She was born September 11th, 1975, to Tony and Marion Myers Appelhans at St. Mary's Hospital in Grand Junction, Colorado. She was the youngest of four children. She was named after one of Tony's favorite jazz songs, Laura. Her grandma Mary was born on the same day. She always laughed after meeting her husband, Uncle Jared, that she would have been born 7 minutes later. She would have been born on his grandma Thaddeus's birthday. Growing up on the family farm and ranch, she was always a helping hand, from irrigating, working cows. She loved to ride bikes on the family farm and learned to tie her shoes real early in life because her sisters refused to do it for her. Laura showed both horses and market steers in 4-H. She was honored to be named Chapter Sweetheart of Montrose FAA Chapter in 1992 and 93. In 1993, she graduated from Montrose High School and then attended Mesa State College. Laura then went to work for her dad, Grandpa Tony, from 1995 to 2016 at Base Products as a bookkeeper and a loader operator. Many of the truck drivers there always said that she could load a truck better than some men. And Laura met the love of her life, Uncle Jared, and they were married in June 20, on June 23rd, 2001. A few years later, June 12th, 2006, they were blessed with their son, Tanner, the second love of her life. They went on many adventures, from traveling to HA horse shows, hunting trips in Oklahoma, touring old coal mines, and off-roading with friends. Many trips were taken out of state, either to visit her brother Matt's family in Alaska, her niece Doreen's graduation in Utah, or my wedding in Georgia. Their favorite place to go as a family was the cabin house on Big Piney in the castle's private property. Some of her hobbies included antiquing, hunting in Big Piney, or on the family farm, or gardening. She enjoyed cooking and was actually a phenomenal cook. Her husband and son were well fed. Tanner and Laura both loved to draw and paint, and they watched Bob Ross together, always remembering there are no mistakes, just happy accidents. Laura had a passion for horses and loved the show world. One of her crowning moments was placing eighth in the Western riding at the Level 1 Championships in Las Vegas in 2017 with her mare, Martina. She enjoyed showing with her horse family, like her bonus niece, Haley. This spring, she was really excited to start her show season. Her heart was made of gold, and everyone seemed to know it, including the animals. Any animal that was in need became the new family pet. This included Tanner's 4-H show animals. She enjoyed helping him with those show animals, the pigs, the horses, but the steers, those were her favorite. Laura enjoyed helping her nephews, Colt and Tyler, as well as the other Oak Grove Jolly Rancher 4-H clubs. And anyone else in that barn that needed any help or may be in need, she was always the go-to person for the livestock kids if they needed to show a horse or on short notice. A sheep stand was always a perfect stand-in for a horse. Laura was a show mom. She enjoyed seeing the kids learn and succeed. Not a bad thing could be said about Aunt Laura. Everyone knew that you could rely on her for whatever you may need. She wouldn't hesitate to be there for her family or friends, even if it meant putting her life on hold for them. She was an active member of the Uncompahgre Cattlemen's Association, serving as a secretary and a member of the Uncompahgre Cattlewomen's Association. The last few months, she spent her time being a stay-at-home mom and a teller at Home Loan State Bank. Laura was preceded in death by her parents, Tony and Marion Applehands, father-in-law Richard Castle and Jim Mueller, grandparents John and Mary Applehands, Robert and Christine Myers, Emmett and Theus Castle, and Mary and Wanda Liskum. Cousins Bobby Myers, Yvonne Alves, Jared Stadelman, and Chandra Castle. Laura is survived by her husband of 22 years, Jared Castle, and their son, Tanner, of Montrose. Mother-in-law, Diana Mueller, also of Montrose. Brother, Matt Applehands, and wife, of Mary, of Anchor Point, Alaska. Sisters, Amy Van Dyke and husband Terry of Clifton, Colorado. Tracy Reed and husband Brett of Montrose, Colorado. Brother-in-law Sean Castle of Montrose, Colorado. Her bonus sister, Jody Reed, and husband Brian of Montrose, Colorado. Nieces and nephews, Sarah and Dan Raven, Thomas and Grace Applehands. Doreen Van Dyke, Adrian Applehands, Chance Van Dyke, Anthony Applehands, Lindsay and David Craig, Sebastian Applehands, Caleb Applehands, Katrina and James Dial, Tyler and Colt Reed, and a bonus niece, Haley Reed. Great nieces, Gracelyn Craig and Rosalyn and Selena Dial. Aunts and uncles, Eleanor Schlager of Grand Junction, Colorado, Kathy Applehands of Montrose, Colorado, Eddie Applehands of Montrose, Colorado, Shirley Myers of Mancos, Colorado, Virginia Stadelman of Elko, Nevada, Marvin Hermans of Cortez, Colorado, and Wes and Renee Myers of Greeley, Colorado, Paul and Beverly Castle, Danny and Brenda Castle, and Randy and Rhonda Castle, both of Montrose, Colorado, as well as numerous cousins and other extended family and friends.
Well, Tom, thank you for sharing. That's a lot of names. Celebration of Life Service. Could you imagine being at that table for Thanksgiving? You better get a number, you know, Christmas gifts. But that's what makes family, right? A mom who cares, a woman who loves people, loves her family, loves the pets. Did you hear that? When a pet came around or some stray, it become part of the family. That's a heart that the Lord gives us, a heart to accept, a heart to love. And we thank you, Tom, again for sharing. We're going to have a song entitled Laura, again, by Earl Gardner. It's a jazz piece, but it's special because it was played to Laura by her dad. Some of you're saying, okay, jazz? We're ranchers, most of us? Yeah, we're different, all of us, and we always have a little piece of this and a little piece of that. Enjoy this song. That is skill. That is love to play that song. Wow. We are going to have a time of special sharing, and we're going to ask Diana Muller to come up, mother-in-law.
Laura Jean Castle, the woman who loved my son, the woman who gave me a grandson, my daughter-in-law. Jim and I first met Laura at Dairy Queen. She was with her sister Tracy and her brother-in-law Brett, and we were there for a night with the car club. Jim and Brett talked cars, that being nothing unusual for those two, and I got acquainted with Tracy and Laura. I was impressed with Laura because of her sweet personality and her quick musical laugh. When we started to leave, I made a comment to Jim that I wished that Jared would find someone like Laura, from my mouth to God's ear. Jared and Brett were friends, and Jared was introduced to that wonderful young woman that I wished for. And they began dating. At Christmas time, Jared came home and told us he had asked her to marry him, and she had accepted. So we started making wedding plans for June of 2001. They wanted to be married in the Presbyterian Church, as that is where our family were members at the time. One of the requirements was premarital counseling. After they finished their counseling one Sunday after service, the counselor, Pam, came to me and told me she had never had a couple so suited for one another. Laura was always willing to help me, whether it was teaching me how to plant flowers or taking over holiday cooking when I was no longer able to host them. I have many memories of the woman with the great smile and the musical laugh. But I'm most grateful for the woman who loved my son wholeheartedly. The mother that she was, that was sweet and gentle for Tanner. I wish I had let her know how much I loved her and what an honor it was to have her as my daughter-in-law. Laura, I love you, and I know we will see you again.
Thank you, Dana. We're going to have Tyler Reed, a nephew, come up and share.
I think I'm going to stick to the cards today. I want to thank you all for coming for Auntie. Very rarely did I call her Aunt Laura. When I was very young, I couldn't pronounce L's. They sounded more like O's. So Auntie Laura came out Auntie Aura. After a while, I just shortened it to Auntie. And no offense to my other aunts, but my Auntie was my favorite. Throughout my life, I was very fortunate to spend a lot of time with her. When trying to think of specific stories, picking one is almost impossible, because she was always there for our family. We would ride bikes in the yard at Grandma and Grandpa's, Auntie, Doreen, Tanner, Budger, and myself. She used to take and turn the dirt in Grandma's garden to make it loose for us boys to dig in and make a big mess, while her and Grandma would watch us from under the shade of a blanket hung on the clothesline. We also would go for walks on the hillside looking for asparagus. Her horse, Little Horse, was the first horse that I ever rode, and the first two words that I put together were horse show. And I'm not quite sure who was prouder, my mom, my Aunt Jody, or my auntie. She's the one who found my first horse, Sunny, and was one of the people who helped me to ride and to show her. Auntie was always teaching, no matter what the situation be, and sometimes you never even knew it. The list of things that I learned from her is innumerable. She was always my go-to person to ask a livestock problem or to ask any question about family history. In the past couple years, I've become very involved in genealogy work and was able to trace the Appelhans family back to Germany in the year 1707. She was so excited to listen to what I had found and to share stories and knowledge that she had for me to write down. Being close to family was very important to her, and that she passed on these stories and information. For example, this suit was my Grandpa Tony's, and it was made at Davis Clothing in Delta. Auntie always used to tell me that she remembered when he went to pick it up in 1986. After Grandpa had died, somehow she made sure that I got it. and I'm honored to wear it for Grandpa, Grandma, and Auntie. When something happens to a loved one, we, as human beings, search for an answer. Why did we have to lose her? But I know she's up there in a big white farmhouse with golden trim, getting ready for all of us to be together again. Before I leave today, or leave you today, I'd like to share one last item that Auntie gave me. This was a book that she had as a teenager, and she found it when we were cleaning out Grandma and Grandpa's house. It's A River Runs Through It by Norman McLean. I opened it this past Sunday to search for some message to close this with, and the bookmark was on the final page where this message lies. Eventually, all things merge into one, and a river runs through it. The river was cut by the world's great flood and runs over rocks from the basement of time. On some of the rocks are timeless raindrops. Under the rocks are the words, and some of the words are theirs. I love you, Auntie.
Thank you. Thank you, Tyler. We're going to have Kelt. Sorry, I dropped my glasses. Colt. Mr. Colt Reed. Also a nephew. Thank you, Colt.
All righty. Thank you all for coming. I am not as prepared as my little big brother, and I don't have any note cards, because I knew I'd be slipping and stumbling like Bambi on ice. My Aunt Laura was a very special lady, and she knew her horses. This past year, it might have been between my aunt, my cousin Haley, and my mom, or it might have been Sheldon almost putting me in a headlock and getting me to do horse judging. But I got the wild hair to go judge horses through FFA. Auntie taught me a lot, Haley taught me a lot, Mom taught me a lot, but Aunt Laura taught me the most. I went over there countless times and we judged her horses, and I figured out what I was doing and what I was doing wrong. And needless to say, I did good, because my team and I ended up getting second at state with FFA, qualifying us to go judge Quarter Horse Congress. For those of you who are not involved in the horse world, Quarter Horse Congress is the second largest horse show in the world, next to AQHA World. And I went there, and there's multi-million dollar horses. But there's this one Western Pleasure horse that sticks out like a sore thumb. It's a red roan called Kissing the Girls. Aunt Laura's mare, she's certainly easy, was AI'd by Kissing the Girls. And me and my buddy Sheldon Collin are sitting there staring at a Western Pleasure class, and here comes this red roan, Kissing the Girls. Needless to say, we're sitting there staring at this horse. I look like a deer in the headlights. And apart from us constantly sitting there texting my mother and aunt going, why are they doing this? Why are they doing that? Why do they have black chaps? I'm sitting there staring at this horse going, that's a real nice horse. She picked a good one. Then came the judging part. One of the classes was Western Pleasure. And here comes this red roan, Kissing the Girls. And I actually aced that class and got all four of them right. Thank you all for coming. My aunt was very special. And judging by the turnout, she touched many people's hearts like she touched all of our family. Love you, Auntie.
Thank you, Colt. I'm going to have Tanner come on up.
I don't know what to really say. I mean, like, she was pretty much the perfect mom. She was my teacher and my best friend. So I guess here's some stories with my mom, what I really liked, so I picked them out. About 3 years ago, on our lean-to thingy, barn we built, the roof blew off, and so we had to go get new metal. So mom and dad shimmied up on the roof, and I stayed on the ground and threw them up metal. And after we got it all done, Dad gets down, and Mom didn't want to get down off the roof. The ladder was about like you had to drop about that much. Mom didn't want to get off. So we brought the tractor over, and Dad puts the tractor bucket up, and she just kind of didn't gracefully get into the bucket. No, she just flops into the bucket. And she starts going, "Don't take a picture. I look pathetic." So I took a picture of her in this bucket. We get her down, and she looked funny in it. And then there was the time when she'd take me to Grandpa's gravel pit, and she would allow me to run in the loader, and I got to sit on a tin can with what's called a hard hat on it. That was my seat. And I remember I'd ask her, "Just go get a scoop of dirt and pick it up in the air and just drop it again." And she would do that, and I would enjoy it because it was interesting to watch. Eventually, when I got old enough and we started cleaning up Grandma and Grandpa's farm, they allowed me to run the loader, and Mom was the person who taught me how to run it. Every second I ran that loader, I enjoyed it. And then later, about I think 2 years ago, I told Mom I wanted to mark the field. I've never done it, so I wanted to try it. So she said, "Wait about 20 minutes, I'll get halfway done, you come out and I'll show you how to mark it." So I go out there, I get into the tractor, and she tells me to look at the little triangle thingy in the front of the tractor and look for your rows. I didn't see no rows, it was just flat. I don't know what she was talking about. There was rows there, but there wasn't. So I start marking, and my marks went straight and then went curved and curved and squiggled and went over there. She told me that was good enough and that she'll come back and try to fix it again. Maybe someday I'll be able to mark a straight row. Hopefully. That's about it I was going to say. I love you, Mama.
Thank you, Tanner. Brett Reed, brother-in-law.
I was told I had to write this out, otherwise I'd babble even worse than Colt did. Everybody said thank you for coming. I'm going to say it again. We appreciate it from the family. It means a lot to see all of these people here. Laura touched a lot of lives, including mine. I met Laura 34 years ago when Tracy and I started dating. We started out, it was the senior party after graduation, and Tracy and I was talking, and Laura sat on my lap and used our money and gambled the night away. Was a lot better at it than I was. She was always the little sister that I wanted. And the three of us did a lot together over the years. When Tracy went off to college, Laura was the fill-in. I'd go grab Laura, we'd go get a hamburger, we'd go bowling, we'd go to the movies, we'd drag my brother along. We just did whatever we wanted to do to have fun. It was after Tracy and I were married that we become even more closer and we did more together. We were a lot like the three amigos the Three Stooges, and Three's Company all put together. We took a lot of trips. My mother-in-law tagged along in quite a few. We did everything from horse shows to mud runs to stock cars, some car shows, a couple trips to Vegas. Laura was always the co-pilot, and I was always the driver when Mom didn't feel like driving. We were on our way back from Grand Canyon one year, and Laura was supposed to remind me where to turn to go to Cortez. We're cruising along. Mom's sitting in the back seat with Tracy, and she says, "Isn't that Shiprock? That seems to be getting a lot closer." I looked at Laura, and I said, "Well, did we pass it?" She goes, "No, it's right up here. I know it is." Next thing we know, we're in the town of Shiprock. Laura's like, "It's okay, Mom. Brett just took the long way." We always had a thing where we tried to embarrass each other, and I think I ended up conceding more than not. We were in Target Junction one year. I know Tracy's going to kill me for this, but she was shopping for a new bra. And Laura and I was just goofing around, and I found it was like a 44H. And I pulled it back, and I smacked Laura in the side of the head with it and told her, "Look, a Chinese slingshot." Well, about the time that happens, a couple comes around the corner, and they're mortified. And Laura just grinned. We leave there. We go to Sam's Club. We're looking through back when you could actually buy CDs. We're looking through, and Laura goes, "Smell my finger." And I look up, and it's the exact same couple in front of us. So we buy a CD. It said Harley Davidson on it. It had to be good. I don't know. It was motorcycles and cars. Couldn't go wrong. So we put it in the Suburban. We're cruising home. And all of a sudden, this song, "The Smell," comes on. And the three of us just lost it. We had to pull over. We were laughing so hard. We were kind of the perfect trio, because I always come up with some harebrained idea. Tracy was always the Debbie Downer that reminded us that it's probably not a good idea or the cops might get called. And Laura was always the one that was game to do whatever. Through the years, Tracy and I had a mud truck, and we ran three stock cars after that. And Laura drove all of them at some point. We'd take the stock cars down to the farm. We'd take them up in the gravel pit to take pictures, whatever. And let's face it, I'm not exactly the smallest guy in the world, so Laura fit in the car a lot easier than I ever did, so she drove it a lot. With Jared, Casey, Misty, Tracy, and I, and Laura, we decided one year that we were going to put the car in for fun day, and we entered it in a powder puff race, and Tracy wasn't about to drive it. Laura said, "I can do it." I said, "All right." So gave her a little pointers, and she said, "I'm not just going to go drive around." She said, "I watched Casey. He sucked." She said, "I'm going to go out. I'm going to win it." I said, "Whatever you want to do. You know how it goes. You know what you got to do." It was a simple 10-lap race, and in 10 laps, Laura lapped the third-place car. She was flying. Very proud. I got a lot of pictures at the house, and it's not me in the car. It was my sister. I kind of got off my notes. I'm sorry. It was great when Jared and Laura started the date, because I wasn't outnumbered anymore. And had been on a few dates with previous boyfriends, and Jared just fit. We knew that Jared was the one. I didn't have to worry about her anymore. I knew she was going to be taken care of. It was amazing how much they completed each other. We took several trips, just the four of us, whether it was to Oklahoma, Whether we went hunting, we went to a car show or two, we got in trouble for passing Grandma Di and Papa Jim on the interstate at 85. But it sure, it was great to see Auntie, I'll just call her Auntie, as an aunt. We had plenty of practice with Matt and Mary's kids and Amy's kids, but then the last three come along, and Laura was simply just known as Auntie from then on. We always knew that Tyler would design a bridge, Tanner would build the bridge, and Colt would be the one to blow it up. Through the years, it became more and more obvious how close Tracy and Laura were. They got accused of being each other several times. We got accused of being twins. Jared and I got accused of being brothers. When they got married, we were asked how our wedding was, and at that point, Tracy and I had already been married 9 years, and it was pretty good then. Laura and Tracy always remain close. I think this was really evident last year when I got some unexpected news. And Laura helped not just me through my cancer treatment, but my wife get through it, because it was the same cancer that their mother had. And Laura knew what to expect and told us what we needed to do and what not to do. The last conversation that I had on my phone was Laura telling me what to do about my treatment. We all poked fun at each other. Whether it be Uncle Jared and Tanner got the better cook and we got the Cajun version or whatnot. But this past Christmas, we were swapping stories, and Jared tells us a story of Laura stepping in the gated pipe cap and falling down, and she couldn't get it off of her foot. So we're laughing, and Laura's laughing right along with us. And Jared says, "Dude, I'm not joking. Every day, it's something." Tyler says, "It's okay, Uncle Jared. We got the older version at our house." So we come up with the saying every day. Every time you did something that was goofy or wrong or whatever, all you said was every day. So after Monday, after Laura's passing, Tracy and I were talking. We were standing in the kitchen, and Tracy's thumbing through her phone, looking at pictures. And the first picture that she pops up with Laura, we were at, it was after Tom's wedding. We were in Georgia at the aquarium, and Laura pops up in the penguin habitat, and all you see is her head, her smile, and a big hand. And I made the comment that Laura smiled every single day. So now, Tracy and I saying to each other is two simple words. And I ask that you remember this. You try this every morning when you get up. All you have to say is every day. And remember that Laura put a smile on a lot of faces, whether it be yours or someone else. Do it for her. Thank you, folks. Love you, sis.
Thank you, Brett. We have a slideshow coming up. You're going to enjoy it, so I'd like to draw your attention up to the screen.
What day is it? And in what month? This clock never seems so alive. I can't keep up, and I can't back down. I've been losing so much time. 'Cause it's you and me and all other people. Nothing to do, nothing to lose, and it's you.
keep my eyes off of you. What are the things that I want to say just aren't coming out right? I'm tripping on words, you got my head spinning. I don't know where to go from here. Cause it's you and me and all other people, nothing to do. Nothing to lose, and it's you and me and all other people, and I don't know why I can't keep my eyes up from you and me and all other people. Nothing to do, nothing to prove. Can't keep my eyes off of you. What day is it? And in what month? This clock never seems so alive.
I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm for me down. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer. So much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and
and I see my Maker's face. I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going. Oh, when I get where I'm going,
good morning. I'm Arlen Geigley from the Sunnyview, pastor of the Sunnyview congregation, Sunnyview Mennonite congregation. And Jared and Laura have been like family to us. He's worked for me for over 19 years. And I just really thank God for their friendship and for the times that we had together. As the family was sharing, Laura was just always had that happy smile. And she was a very kind and compassionate woman. And just would be a friend to anyone. And so I really cherish that friendship. You know, and as we come together here today, our hearts are grieving. We're sorrowing because our friend, our wife, our mother, our auntie, our sister, she's left us. God has called her name. And she has went on to her reward, and it's left an empty hole here for us. She filled a big role in the family. I was talking to Jared and Tanner and all the things that she did and keeping the family going. And then all of her community involvements. She's going to leave a big hole. But as I said before, I just really count it a privilege to be able to know her and her family. You know, the Appelhanses, I've learned to know them before I ever had the business there of Montrose Implement. And I'd go out there and get gravel and talk to Tony, and they were, you know, and then go in and pay my bill to Laura, or, you know, get the scale ticket. And so I knew that family, and then Jared came to work for me after they were married, and it's just been a wonderful time to be able to have them as a family. You know, Matt told me last evening, he said, you know, I think I'm going to soon have to adopt you. You've been involved in our family's life. And I told him, I said, well, you don't have to adopt me. I'm just part of your family anyway. So I grieve with you. And Jared and Tanner and the Appelhans and Castle family, as you look around and you see this house filled with your friends, those that have come to share this time with you. And then as we sang that song, or that song was played there, Amazing Grace, I had to think, how amazing is the grace of God in that he saves us from our sins so that we can have the hope of eternal life. His grace then also is sufficient for these times that we go through, the times of trials, the times of suffering. God's grace is sufficient. And so I share with you the family. Trust in that grace. Fall upon the grace of God. It's the only thing that can get us through. It's the only thing that is there for us. It's the grace of God for each day, for each thing that we face as we begin life without our companion. And so we pray for God's grace to be upon you. So as we think about Laura, and you know, we wonder why. Why did God call her to her eternal reward so suddenly and so soon? You know, we don't know. I don't know. But we must trust God's providence. In Isaiah 55:9, this verse says there, as the heavens are higher than the earth and our ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are your thoughts. I think I messed that up there. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. That's our God. He says, I know you don't understand, but I want you just to trust me. I want you just to rest in me, because I care for you. So I believe God, as we look at her passing, I believe God has some things he wants us to learn. Although we don't understand why he called her and why she left so early, why she was taken so suddenly, we didn't get the time to say goodbyes or whatever, you know, why did it go that way? But yet I believe God has some lessons for us. And this morning I'd like to think a little bit about that. The lessons that we can learn from the passing of Laura. The first one I have, I think, that we need to remember is our days are numbered and our breath is in God's hands. Job 12:10 says, in whose hands the soul of every living thing and the breath of all, in whose hand is the soul of every living thing and the breath of all mankind. God holds every one of our breaths in his hands. Every breath that we take is a gift from God. We don't know how many we have. But I believe as we see how quickly Laura was taken from us, it should be a lesson. God is trying to show us that our days are in his hands. Our breath is in his hands. And so we need to trust him. Psalm 37:18, the Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. I believe another lesson that we can learn, that God wants to teach us by the passing of our friend Laura, is that there is no one that can retain the spirit or life when God calls for it. You know, the doctors tried, Jared tried, but her spirit went back to God who gave it. Ecclesiastes 8:8, there is no man that hath power over the spirit to retain the spirit, neither hath he power in the day of death. And there is no discharge in that war, neither shall wickedness deliver those that are given to it. Again, showing us that God is in control of our lives. And so when he calls, we will answer. And another lesson I think we can learn that God wants to teach us is we must always be ready to die. We must always be ready to die. Matthew 24:44 says, therefore, be ye also ready, for in such as an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. I know he's talking about the second coming there, but I believe he also can come for us individually, just like he did for Laura. He can come back for us individually. And so we must be always ready to die. We must live every day as our last day and ready to prepare and prepared to stand before our Creator God. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the thing done in his body according that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Showing us that as we leave this earth, we were going to stand before our Creator God as our judge. And as we talk a little bit later, we need to make that preparation so that we can stand before him as his child. If we make those preparations here and we accept him as our Lord and our Savior, then we can hear those welcome words, come on home, my good and faithful servant. So we need to live every day as our last before our Creator God. Hebrews 9:27, as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. Also John 5:28-29, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So I believe those are some lessons that God wants to teach us as we mourn the death of our loved one here this morning. He wants us to always remember that our time is in his hands, and we must be ready to meet him. So how can we be assured, or how can we reserve this place in heaven? And be assured of that place in heaven. Well, I believe the first thing we need to do is we must recognize that we're a sinner. We must recognize that and admit that we're a sinner and we need a Savior. That we can't save ourselves. We can't do enough of good works to save ourselves. It's only by the grace of Jesus Christ. It's only by his finished work there in Calvary. Romans 3:23 says that we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So there's no one that is born perfect. There is no one that can be perfect. It's only as we're in Christ. And so the way that we must first of all recognize that and admit that we're a sinner and we need a Savior. Romans 5:12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. As Adam there in the garden and Eve partook of that fruit that God had commanded them not to, that brought sin into the world, and that's what brought in the death and the suffering and the dying and all those things. It is because of sin. But because of the love of God for each one of us, in John 3:16 it says, but God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting. Praise God. We don't need to stay in our sins, but God has given the remedy by sending his Son, Jesus, to be our Savior. Romans 5:8-9, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Praise God for that amazing gift of salvation that we have in Christ Jesus. So how can we be assured of this place in heaven? It's as we confess that we're sinners, we need a Savior, and we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You don't need a certain amount of money. You don't need to do a certain work, whatever it is. We need to believe that Jesus is the way unto the Father. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And so it's our faith and our trust in the Lord Jesus and his finished work there on that cross of Calvary that guarantees us that inheritance in the eternal heaven with our blessed Lord and Savior. Romans 8:1-2 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. What a beautiful place to be, under no condemnation. Our sins forgiven and removed as far as the east and the west, and therefore we can have a relationship with our holy God. And we can walk with him each day, and his grace is sufficient for everything that we need to go through or what he leads us to. And so we need to trust in the Lord Jesus. That's our only hope. That's our only, yes, our only hope. And then I believe another important part is we need to obey his word. You know, the past Saturday there when we were here celebrating the life of Jim, Brother Ben mentioned about the B-I-B-L-E, the basic instructions before leaving earth. And I just think that is so true, dear brothers and sisters and friends here today. If you want to follow the Lord Jesus, then we need to take time in his word. We need to go into his word. And there's where we find our strength. There's where we find our hope. There's where we find all that we need to go through this life safely and go safely to the other shore. And so we need to obey his word. Revelation 22:14 says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and that they may enter in through the gates into that city. And then in Matthew 7:21, Jesus says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. So we must believe, we must confess that we are sinners. We must believe that Jesus is a sacrifice for that sin. He's the answer for that sin. We must then trust him to forgive us and to cleanse us and to adopt us into his family. And as we do that, then we seek to obey him and to follow him in all of our life. So this morning, my plea to each one of us is don't let the passing of our loved one here be in vain. But I believe God wants to use this to help us remember, be reminded that our days are numbered. We don't know when that call will come for us, but if it was you or I in that casket today, would we know where we're going? And so I just pray that we each would take heed, that we would get into the Word, and that if you haven't been, if you're not a Christian or you haven't received Christ as your Savior, that you would do that now, because now is the day of salvation. We don't know about tomorrow. We don't know about the rest of this day. But we know that Jesus loves us, died for us, and he's coming back for us. May God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Arlen. And you folks are very fortunate. You get to hear from Pastor Arlen, and now you're going to hear from me. Two for the price of one. We don't waste our times as pastors. We're grateful that the Lord gives us these opportunities. Shortly, of course, you're going to be going up to the Hogback up there and for the interment. And then there's going to be food available, as you all know already. But before that, I want to share also a little message. And it's based on Luke's gospel. And it's entitled The Choices. So friends and family, this life is full of choices. We make over 100 decisions each day. We have to decide what time to get up. We have to make a decision on what clothes to wear for the day or for work. And then there's another set when we get home. We have to decide which way to go to work, or even if we're going to go to work. We have to take care of other things all day long. The choices are always before us. We never face a day without choices. So, friends and family, today we have a choice to make. The choice is where are we going to spend eternity, as Pastor Arlen mentioned. Some of us already have made that choice. That's good. Others don't want to even think about it. You know people like that? Don't talk to me about death. I don't want to know. I just don't want to get there. But one day, that choice will be final. As we gather in honor of Laura Jean Castle, we are faced with an important question. Where will we spend eternity when we leave the earth? There were two men that we read about in the Gospel of Luke. Some call this a parable, but parables don't usually use proper names, and we are given a vivid account of two types of people. The first man we read about is a rich man. And the Bible says there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. Here we learn a few things about this man. He was rich. He wore fine clothes. He lived in luxury, excuse me, every day. So this man, who had everything that money could buy, he had taken hold of life and lived it up to the hilt. He had no worries from a human perspective. Everyone, or mostly everyone, was sure loved to live this way. We often wish that we could do anything we wanted to do, go any place we wanted to go without worrying about cost. Here was that person. He did it his way. He didn't need anyone. He was independently wealthy. The second man we read about in this context of Luke, his name was Lazarus. The Bible says there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, at the rich man's gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. And moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Friends, family, we also learn a few things about this second man, do we not? He was a beggar. He had no place to live except on the street. He was sick. He was full of sores. He was satisfied with the crumbs from the rich man's table. And his only friends were dogs, and dogs were his only medical help. Here is a man that no one really wants to be. He had nothing. He was looked down on by all those around him. In fact, this man was friendless. So Christ told this story to let people know, like you and I, that there are two types of individuals in this world.
those who depend on themselves, and those who depend on others. This beggar did trust in God for help and comfort, as we learn from the outcome of his death. Two choices. Not only did these men differ in their lifestyle, they also differed greatly in their personal choices. All of us have the same choices to make. Lazarus, the Bible says, so it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. Family and friends, the beggar died, but he had no known burial. He was carried by the angels to the place of comfort, also referred to as Abraham's bosom. And we learn later that this is a place called paradise by our Lord Jesus Christ, Luke 23:24. Now, paradise, or Abraham's bosom, is a place for those who believe in Jesus Christ to save them from the punishment of sin and give their lives to him as Lord. Lazarus made that choice. The rich man? The Bible says the rich man also died and was buried. And being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham answered, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and you are tormented. And besides all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, I beg you therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. And Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead. And this section has been Luke chapter 16, 22 through 31. Family and friends, so the rich man dies also. He has a funeral and is buried. The rich man goes to a place called Hades, or hell, which is a place of torment. And while he's there, the rich man wants mercy. And he quickly learns that after death, there is no mercy. He also learned from Abraham that the Bible is the only source of learning about life and death. Most of all, he learned that the choices made in this life affect our eternal life. The rich man made the wrong choice. He ignored Scripture, the book that directs us to Jesus and eternal life. So, family and friends, as we conclude, each one of us here today has a choice to make concerning eternity. We can choose to believe in Christ, following him as Lord, or we can live for ourselves with no hope of the future, for the future. If we choose Jesus Christ, then there needs to be a change that includes, as Pastor Arlen was saying, confession of sin and belief in the gospel of Christ. The gospel tells us that Christ died on the cross for our sins. He was buried, and he rose from the dead to show us the way to heaven. And if you want more information regarding this way of life, please see Pastor Arlen or see myself after the service. But the second choice is to go our own way and live as if this life was the only place that mattered. Once this choice is made, we will have to live with this decision for all eternity. Remember that being rich doesn't mean you cannot go to heaven. No, there are some rich people who know the Lord Jesus Christ. But if we trust in our riches or anything else more than Christ, we may find ourselves in the place of torment throughout eternity. Laura Jean Castle, in whose honor we gather this day, has already made her choice. God is just and merciful, and only He knows the decisions made by her. The question is, what choice will you make? What is your choice? Our last song is entitled Mother Like Mine, and it's by the band Perry, and after that we'll close in a prayer.
She's the lady of our house. We all need her, but no one more than me. Oh, the wars would all be over, 'cause she'd raise us all as friends. And no one would ever wonder if somebody wanted them. We'd walk on grass that's greener, and the dishes would all
speaking with Tanner this last few days, he mentioned the Lord's Prayer. It's a prayer that Laura Jean prayed with him often. So you bow your heads. If you know it by memory, you can say it out loud. I'm going to say it out loud, and we're going to conclude with this prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forget our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so, Lord, we do thank you for your goodness and your kindness. We thank you for giving us a building that we could just meet and we can laugh, we can cry. Lord, we can call on your name. We can see friends and family, Lord. And we can think about heaven. And we hear words about heaven. And it's not so popular anymore. But we open the book, your book, Lord. And we thank you for truth. We're not always happy with truth, Lord. It hurts, but it doesn't kill us. Lord, help us respond to you, to your love in sending your son. And now, Lord, comfort, continue to comfort us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are going to dismiss 99% of you, the majority of you. The family requests that you go up to the Hogback where we're going to be laying the body to rest and we're going to have a few minutes of a commitment service there. The family, the immediate family, is going to remain here right now. And they're going to remain here, and I have a few moments with the body. So would you stand, those of you who are not going to stay, are not part of the immediate family, would you exit through the doors in the back? And then we're going to ask the immediate family to remain. Pallbearers, I believe you're part of the family, so would you remain as well? And then we'll turn it over to Crippen. You are dismissed at this time. Our ushers are here.